come to a U behind me. Behind the governor and our local leader. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Governor Kathy Hochul on what is can only be described as a tragic day here in Oneida County in the city of Rome. I'm joined by the county executive, Tony Pacenti, who I've worked with through many crises, but this is the worst event to ever hit the city of Rome in its long 228-year history. Also, a mayor who's fairly new on the job but is now seasoned in dealing with disasters, that is our mayor, Jeffrey Lanigan. I spoke to both individuals literally minutes after the tornado, if that's how it's going to be categorized, and I cannot imagine it'll be called anything else, but the National Weather Service has to do their official designation, but let's say it's a tornado. We were in communication instantaneously. I just toured the downtown with my commissioners. We have the head of the DOT, the head of the Public Service Commission, our representation from Homeland Security. We have state police, our superintendent has joined us. We have so many individuals from state fire police. Everybody you can think of is on the ground here. We toured this community, but first I will say, as I was landing, coming in from New York City to make sure I was here, you cannot imagine the impact of seeing from the sky how vast the destruction is. When you see entire swaths of trees just collapsed like they were toothpicks. And then houses, the roofs gone. Churches, St. Mary's, which had been here since the late 1800s, a fixture in our community. And then you get on the ground. We landed at Griffiths. If you want to know the power of this tornado, take note of the fact that a B-52 bomber was tipped on its side. That weighs 183,000 pounds. That's the ferocity of the storm that ravaged this community. Devastation unleashed by Mother Nature over the past 24 hours, as I said, is the worst natural disaster in the history of this community. What is so miraculous, so incredibly miraculous, that in this city of Rome, barely a block not affected. No loss of life. It was close for people. We saw a building where a new chiropractic office just opened last August, all excited, converting the old church property into new life, businesses. You look up and you see a room that is absolutely obliterated. The ceiling collapsed. It just looks like a war zone. And then you learn that there were two children who had been sitting in the waiting room waiting for their mom to arrive, who escaped unharmed. If that's not the hand of God protecting the people of this city, then I don't know what is. So we're grateful that people are survived the experience, especially those who had been in the Georgian Towers. Senior citizens, that's their home. The top floor, the seventh floor, collapses, and people walked out and are now being taken care of over in Utica. So those are just some of the reflections of walking for a short trip down to this community. It says to me this is a community built on resiliency and a toughness and a can-do spirit, as I talk to countless business owners who promised to rebuild, but also for our government workers displaced, our Office of Mental Health. People, some of our neediest in the community, had walked into these buildings getting services that were so essential for them. Seriously damaged. It'll be months, if not years, before they can be restored. The county offices, you'll hear from the county executive. The social services, all the basic services that we give to our people to help them get through life, are now damaged and compromised. But we were committed to doing whatever it takes to rebuild these services, these communities, the buildings. Because in a moment of crisis, what I saw so clearly evident here this morning, in a moment of crisis, New Yorkers always unite. We come together. And so I want to thank my state partners as well. Senator Joe Griffo, once the mayor of this community, this hits personally for him. Assembly Member Marianne Buttonshan, who has been speaking to me about how we can continue providing services to the neediest of this community. Because there is need. I met with one family who lived in an RV. The mom, daughter, son, son-in-law, and a one-year-old. The RV was just knocked right over. They ran for their lives. They are in need of services. So to this community, we'll not abandon you. We'll continue to bring the resources from the state of New York, now and for as long as it takes. So who's on the ground here? I brought the best. I have the most experienced team. We have been through so many disasters. I've been governor less than 3 years. I've had to deal with more historic nature events, cataclysmic, extreme weather events than probably anybody in history. You know, hurricanes, tornadoes. Remember last week there were 42 tornado warnings from Jamestown up to Plattsburgh. Never before in our state's history have we had that scale of impacts from Mother Nature. So the point is, my team is experienced. They're the best. Director of State Operations, Catherine Garcia, is here. Came up with me this morning. She understands disasters like no other. Our State Police Superintendent, Stephen James, been at my side through many of these crises. DOT Commissioner Marie-Therese Dominguez, first thing she did was make sure that we could clear our streets, manage the damage, make sure that our generators were there to make sure that our streets are managed in a safe way. Public Service Chair Roy Christian has joined us here to make sure the utilities do their job, speaking to them nonstop, getting the power back on. And we've gone statewide from over 300,000 without power yesterday to about 100,000 today, about 20,000 here in this county. But this is an urgent situation. When the heat is as hot as it is right now, people need their power back on. So we are focused intensely on making sure that happens as soon as humanly possible. Peter Cicchetti, the Executive Deputy Director, Homeland Security, representing Jackie Bray, who's an incredible individual who's managed crises with me as well. To all the men and women at the Emergency Operations Center at Griffiths Air Force Base, you need to see this. This is a military operation like no other. State, local, city, county, all working together as if they've been trained together since the very beginning. A beautiful synergy that's all working to build up this community and make sure people are safe, working around the clock to monitor the conditions. The reason we're still monitoring, hate to break the news, it's not over yet. Weather conditions created this devastation here in Rome are still in the air above New York. There's potential for tonight to also be another devastating experience. For that reason, I declared a state of emergency for the entire state of New York as we face another period of tornadoes, high winds, thunderstorms, and whatever else Mother Nature throws our way. So let's start with what we see here on the ground in Rome. I'm sure most of you will never forget this, but at 3:27 p.m. yesterday, high winds touched down here in Rome and all the way out to Canasota. And I spoke to the county chairman in Madison and the mayor of Canasota and offered all of our support for them as well. We also had three other tornadoes touch down. Warren County, Hamilton counties as well. But let's talk about Rome since we're here. 22 buildings, major structural damage, 4 entirely destroyed. As I mentioned, the 7th floor of the Georgian Tower collapse. The building next to our Office of Mental Health is now unsafe to enter. And as you see behind us, the steeple blowing off the church, St. Mary's, the First Presbyterian lost part of its roof. Over in the village of Canasota, tragically, there was loss of life. An 82-year-old man, Robert Popple, still determining the specifics, but a neighbor reports he was out trying to check on his antique car outside and was swept away. Let's just recognize this 82-year-old who just was out there living life as one does and unexpectedly swept from us. Let's honor him in a moment of silence. Thank you. So in Canastota, 3 homes collapsed, 30 structures damaged. Red Cross also has a shelter there as well. Now, I don't want to bring bad news back, but we also came through Lewis County just a few days ago. Serious flash flooding, 7 inches of rainfall in the village of Lowville. And state personnel have been on the ground for a week there. If you're ready for this as well, the Canadian wildfires are back. As you recall, last June, Syracuse and the city of New York had the worst air quality on the planet for a period of days because of the smoke coming from the Canadian wildfires in Quebec. We just received reports that that is starting. We're not expecting air quality to be that compromised over this next week, but I want everybody ready for this. Be ready for this. We'll get out more warnings on what people need to do to prepare. To deal with this, you know my team's on the ground. I also said we need more help. We need help with cleanup. We need help with the people. So as of now, I've deployed 50 National Guard to continue with the storm response. They'll help remove debris from public areas and provide assistance as necessary. We also will need the money, right? Need money to rebuild. I spoke with Majority Leader of the United States Senate Chuck Schumer and our Senator Kirsten Gillibrand. Both of them have committed any assistance we need with FEMA, but as you know, we first must calculate the scale of the damage. It has to exceed $37 million in public damage, meaning to roads, bridges, infrastructure, public buildings, libraries, schools, offices. Once that is calculated, we can put in a request and ask for a declaration of disaster from the federal government. So the White House is aware. I've already reached out to them. FEMA has been notified as well. So I've spoken to our leadership team in Washington, and they're ready to assist. So at the state level, we do have some discretionary funds for capital work like roadway repairs if the federal dollars are not sufficient. Our Office of Faith and Nonprofit Services has money to help with churches and religious institutions. And what's really important for those who are trying to figure out how to manage the whole idea of getting insurance coverage for their properties and their homes. The Department of Financial Services is deploying their disaster strike team, and they'll literally set up a trailer people can walk up to. I've seen it many times, that they can get assistance on how to file their claims. So we'll be there for them as well. So we still have our Emergency Operations Center operational right now. We have our incident management team. We have our Office of Fire Prevention. We have our canine search and rescue teams. Countless individuals, even just all the debris that's on the streets look good. That's because teams descended quickly and we call the, sent in the equipment to cut trees and clear debris. And I continue to have the public service with utility workers ready, 5,000 people deployed. So I'm ready to wrap up, but there's a lot going on here. There's a lot going on here. And as I said to the mayor and the county executive many times, whatever you need, we're here to help. We're not abandoning you. And as I said, starting tonight, severe weather storms are expected again, extending here in Rome all the way across the eastern half of the New York. And the highest risk is the capital region to Long Island. More trees coming down, more wires down, localized flash flooding. And it's going to be very hot. Much of the state is now covered in 90-degree weather. It feels like 100. Some parts of our state are going to feel like 105 degrees. Good news is we expect this weather condition to break sometime tomorrow, so continue monitoring the situation as well. So, almost exactly 1 year ago, I stood at a podium like this, 200 miles away in a community called Highland Falls. They had just experienced what was defined as a 1,000-year flooding event. Destroyed the downtown, water raged through as if there were no streets, it was all part of the river. As I said on that day, and have been saying since I became governor, these extreme weather events are no longer the abnormal. They are the new normal. And so this summer, as we're experiencing, historically early heat wave, the most ever tornado warnings, and now this horrific event in the Mohawk Valley. This is going to be what we're going to expect from here on out. But we're ready, we're prepared, and the state of New York will not abandon our communities. So as I look around, I just want to say again, I'm so grateful for the partnership that we have with our local officials. It means everything and hopefully inspires the confidence of a community that has been struck with a disaster that they never could have imagined. But we will rebuild, we will come back, and we will be stronger. With that, I'd like to turn it over to County Executive Tony Pacente.
Thank you, Governor. As the Governor said, it was minutes after this event had happened. I was in this office with the mayor, who we've been kind of joined at the hip for the last 20 hours or so, except for a few hours of sleep. And, and along with Senator Griffo was with us, but minutes really before it even settled, the Governor had called, offered resources, and obviously we were ready and willing and grateful for what happened. The cooperation between the state of New York, the County of Oneida, the City of Rome has been unparalleled. We've been working, as the Governor said, around the clock. We've been establishing various, the command center up at Griffiths International Airport. The terminal building is where the command center is, led by Chief Kevin James, who's the incident commander. The sheriff has been with us throughout and continues. So this has been, as the governor said, a team effort. What we are dealing with now is, continuing the cleanup that has to take place here and really an assessment of the overall damage that has taken place. We have obviously, while City Hall is open for, essential businesses, our county offices and court facilities in the city of Rome are closed. For the time being, we will be establishing some temporary work up at and offices at Griffiths for the time being until we can establish something more stable and permanent in the downtown area, recognizing that people have a hard time getting there. But in terms of social services, mental health, any of the other human services needs, the county is responding and is setting up offices accordingly. We'll continue to do that as we continue to clean up. Our public works crews are working with Rome, and we've had offers from various towns, villages, cities to assist with that, along with state DOT. I won't mention all of the people that the governor already did, but I want to thank all the commissioners that are here and have been at the ready from the moment this thing hit. And I would ask, the other thing is really the credit right now goes to the first responders. I want to especially call out, with my colleague here who's going to speak in a moment, the mayor, Rome Police Department, Rome Fire, who have been outstanding. Oneida County Sheriff's Office, thank you, Sheriff, have been outstanding. New York State Police, public work crews. That, everybody here, literally working around the clock and will continue to do so until we get this cleaned up. Obviously, this comes at a difficult time. It's never a good time. Certainly no time of year, but this is a time of celebration in the Mohawk Valley, whether it's in the city of Rome or in the city of Utica or in elsewhere, throughout this county, and this is the time we're enjoying summer, and we will enjoy summer. We will get there because we will clean up, we will rebound, we will rebuild and do everything we can. We do need the cooperation of the public to please stay out of the way of our emergency workers as they're cleaning up the debris. There's still power lines down. There's still, very hazardous situations. We don't need sightseeing right now. We need people to let the crews do their work and get this job done. But once again, to the governor, for her being here today is very important. For her, calls all last night. Again, I want to thank her. We come together in these emergencies like no other state, I think, and I want to thank you for that, Governor, and for the team behind you. And with that, I will turn it over to my partner, who we've been kind of joined at the hip for the last 20 hours, and that's Mayor Jeff Lanigan. Mayor.
Good afternoon. Thank you so much for being here. I want to first say thank you so much to the governor for her incredible assistance throughout this process right from the beginning. Like we said, within minutes, we were working on this together, and I thank you for everybody that's here today and everybody that you've sent right from day one. County Executive Pacenti, thank you to you. You were here within probably 20 minutes, and we have been joined at the hip. So I appreciate everything you guys have done. Senator Griffo on the state side and Assemblywoman Marianne Buttonshine, same thing. We have an incredible group here within Oneida County that is always willing to help, and that's exactly what we've done to get us to the point that we are right now, which is if you saw this place at 4 o'clock yesterday afternoon, you would have never thought we'd be here where we are right now to be able to walk the streets and even drive the streets. And I give that kudos to our local boots on the ground. These guys risked their lives running to calls that were coming into 911, even to the point where 911 shut down at one point that they couldn't even take any more calls. And these guys were on the street, and I thank all of our local city employees, our men and women. You guys did an incredible job to get us to this point because you were the first ones here, and you guys risked it all to be out there in that. So I thank each and every one of you for that. To our residents of Rome, do not be discouraged. This community is resilient, and we will build back. This is not something to get down on. We're here for you. We are not just somebody that lives here or serves here. Senator Griffo being the former mayor, county executive is deep-rooted in Rome. Assemblywoman Marianne Buttonshine is deep-rooted. This is not just some place we serve. This is our community, and we will make sure that everything gets done here to make this exactly what it was before yesterday's tragedy. And you have the reassurance of everybody standing here in front of you that that will happen, and it will happen quickly. Anybody that knows me knows I'm not going to sit around and wait for things to happen. We're going to make it happen. And I promise you today that will happen. So please be safe, like the county executive said. Let these guys do their job. We're asking to please stay out of their way. We know everybody wants to help, and we appreciate that's what this community does. The smallest tragedies to the most largest ones, as you're seeing today, everybody just wants to lend a hand. But we were truly blessed to have no major injuries and or deaths in our community, and we do not want to see that ever happen in the cleanup efforts. So please be cautious, stay out of their way, let them get that done, and please be safe, everybody. Thank you so much. Thank you, Governor.
All right, folks, we have time for a couple of questions about the storm and recovery. If you can,
resiliency takes many forms. You know, communities that live along rivers, for example, where we were last year with the 1,000-year event, you build up the embankments, you lift up houses and buildings to higher levels, you literally lift up sidewalks and streets to be able to accommodate higher water levels and minimize future damage. But something that comes out of the sky so wildly unexpectedly, like a tornado, is more challenging to build resiliency for. You don't have a clear path. If you live along a waterway, you have a path, you can identify the most vulnerable areas. You can prepare. When it comes so randomly, and the path that you look at this take, it goes like this, it is more challenging, but I think it's how you deal with the aftermath as well. You know, to have teams that are trained, they're integrated, there's no one misses a beat when there is a disaster, getting notices out to people, letting them know the resources that are available to help them build back. You know, we're looking at, you know, finding out if Nourish New York can provide assistance, more assistance to the food bank here, how we can provide the social services in other locations with many of them are state employees as well. Identifying all the problems that arise in the aftermath and hitting them hard and dealing with them. But if there's anything else, anybody else to say about resiliency for anything else like this, Catherine? No? Okay, we're good. Okay. If someone knows how you can plan for a tornado and prevent it, you let me know, because we are now becoming a tornado alley. When you think about what happened last week, it has touched down in Western New York, literally a community next door to my hometown, you know, homes damaged, barns, loss of life of animals. So it hit all the way from Western New York, clearly across the state to hit here now. So it is difficult to plan for, but we're very focused on the aftermath and how we can make sure that people are protected after a storm like this hits.
All right, next question over here.
As I understand, is an Honor America Days coming up next week, Mayor? What are you going to do about that?
That's correct. We have Honor America Days next week, and we're actually working on that. If we're We will not cancel it. I've spoke with the chamber this morning, and it will not be something that is canceled. It is a possibility that it will be moved to a later date, but we're working on that as the parade route is actually one of the worst areas that was hit during this storm. So we'll have an update on that hopefully by the end of the day.
The number?
No, we're really doing an assessment on homes right now. It's more buildings. We think there are many homes are impacted.
Yeah.
Depends on, you know, I mean, the level of impact. I had spoken to the hospital, you know, the mayor and I were in contact with them. They had some typical emergency room visits, you know, but you know, some normal activity and things like this, but nothing serious. Bangs and bruises and things like that. Nothing that raised to a level that we had to, you know, look and see what else could there be. So, as we said, no serious injuries were.
Governor, I know you've got the tour of the damage. Just behind you, such a striking image of that church destroyed. You've seen a lot of damage in New York State. I haven't seen this kind of damage locally. Just wondering your thoughts on what you saw.
No, a tornado has unique characteristics. I mean, anything in its way is struck down, whether it's the trees, the cars that are overturned, the devastation, the damage to the vehicles that are unrecognizable, but then a building that's been here since 1890s that endured all these years. I mean, this community itself goes back to the late 1700s. Nothing like this has ever hit this part of our state. I will tell you, and certainly not the 3 years I've been governor. So no, this is a next level damage that I've witnessed. It's very different than flooding, where you're walking through flooded, you know, the water's up to your knees, you're going through damaged areas all the way up from Lake Ontario to the Hudson Valley, Long Island. I've seen all the flooding. Even a hurricane is damaging, but this is a unique weather event, which by its nature destroys what's in its path. This is heartbreaking to me. The criteria is that for the federal FEMA reimbursements, and we spoke to the White House again today, $37 million of public damage. Now, that could be a bridge, a culvert, roadways, government buildings, libraries, schools, as well as what you think of as traditionally government buildings. So there are a lot of structures that would be encompassed in this. We are also defining this as not just Oneida County. This is the same tornado that hit Canasota. So you would add up the damage in the village there and other damage in Madison County with this and aggregate the two when you do your application. Would I like to add the damage done in Lewis County last week in Lowville? We'll try, but I don't know that I can identify that that's the same weather event, other than it's the same week, and these are extreme conditions. So we'll do everything we can to get the most money we can. Again, Chuck Schumer asked me to say, I will do everything I can to get every penny that's eligible to come back to the state. So we're accustomed to doing this. We've had to do this for historic blizzards and floods throughout the state. But is there anything else I missed on that, Catherine?
No, you're correct, but I think the other piece is that you've committed.
Yeah, the state money.
I just want to reiterate what the governor raised before, is that she is putting state resources behind the effort to rebuild here, and we'll work with the local officials to define what that looks like. But we're already working with our Division of Budget to find those pots.
And I just you know, as declaring the state emergency from the county with, you know, alongside the governor, we've committed in working with the mayor. Oneida County is putting $3 million towards this cleanup event and towards anything needed over the next several days that we've appropriated with the approval of the Board of Legislators. So, you know, we'll be able to purchase what we need and get the resources. Obviously, other than, you know, the various manpower that we have, you know, we're going to need other things such as, you know, equipment, repairs, electrical pieces, generators, other supplies, whatever we need, we'll take care of it over the next couple of weeks.
All right. All right. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, everyone. Appreciate it.